For my angel will go before you and bring you into the Amorite and the Hittite and the Perizzite and the Canaanite and the Hivite and the Jebusite, and I will cut them off. You shall not bow down to the gods, nor serve them, nor do according to the works, but you shall surely overthrow them and completely break down their sacred pillars. So you shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water, and I will take away the sicknesses from the midst of you. No one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren in the land. I will fulfill the numbers of your days. I will send my fear before you. I will cause confusion among the people to whom you come, and will make all your enemies turn their backs to you. And I will send hornets before you, which shall drive out the Hittite, the Canaanite, and the Hivite from before you. That's Exodus chapter 23, from 20 to 28. Now, we are going to see what the Lord is saying to us. First of all, the Lord is saying to us, behold, I sent an angel before you to keep you. That angel that is written in capital A is the angel of the presence of the Lord. It is the pre-incarnation of Christ Jesus. So Christ Jesus did not just start the book of Matthew chapter 1 at his birth. No. That was the physical manifestation of Christ Jesus. But Christ Jesus has always existed. He's God from the beginning. He was with God. In the beginning, God, God the Father, created the heaven and the earth. The earth was void and dark, from darkness covered the face of the deep. But the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the Lord, was hovering over the waters. And then God said, so God the Father was there. The Holy Spirit was there, hovering over the waters. And the Word is Jesus. Jesus is the Word of God. So even from Genesis chapter 1, you have God the Father, God the Son, who is the Word, and God the Holy Spirit, three in one. And as we keep on reading Genesis chapter 1, the Bible says, let us create man, mankind, in our image, and after our own likeness. He did not say, let me, but let us. So God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three in one, and one in three. They are three in one, and one in three. Each one of them has his own personality. Each one of them has his own function in the Godhead. And the angel of the Lord, or the angel of the presence of the Lord, is Christ Jesus. In the book of Genesis chapter 18, the angel of the Lord came with two other angels to visit Father Abraham. And the angel of the Lord, who is Christ Jesus, prophesied over the life of Father Abraham. By this time next year, when I come back, your wife Sarah will be with child. And the other two angels, which are just normal angels, they went down to Sodom and Gomorrah to see what was happening. And Jesus, who is the angel of the Lord, or the angel of the presence of the Lord, did not go down with them. That's why Jesus in the book of John says, Father Abraham saw my days, and he rejoiced over it. And the Jews started to scratch their head. They said, okay, you are not even 50 years old. You are just 30 something. And you say that you have seen Father Abraham. Who do you make yourself to be? And Father Jesus said, I am who I am. Listen, so you are making yourself to be God. You, the man, you think that you are God. Jesus was God in the flesh. The fact that he was physically 30-something years old did not mean that he was 30 years old. He has always been from the beginning. He has no beginning and no end. He is eternal. But he was manifested 2,000 years ago. So you need to understand that Jesus is a fully God, the Holy Spirit is a fully God, and God the Father is a fully God. But they are three in one and one in three. So the angel of the Lord, or the angel of the presence of the Lord, who is Christ Jesus, God the Father said, the angel of the Lord, God is sending Jesus in your life, and Jesus will go before you to keep you in the way that you are going and to bring you into the place which God has already been prepared for you. God has a place that he has prepared for you, the land of a promise. And unless you follow Jesus, unless you follow the lead of Jesus, you will never enter into that place that God has prepared for you, that place that God has promised you. For the children of Israel, it was the land of Canaan, the land that was flowing with milk and honey, where they would have houses, filled with cities, with houses, filled with good things that they did not build. But they need to follow the voice of the angel of the Lord. They need to obey his voice. They need to not disobey Jesus. If you do not have Jesus Christ in your life, you even can have a doctorate in theology, a doctorate in Greek and in Hebrews. You have studied the Bible over and over, gone to Bible college, it will not do you any good. Because you need to have Jesus in your life, the angel of the presence of the Lord, and you need to obey Jesus. There is no way to the Father except through Christ Jesus. John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one can go to the Father except through me. You cannot go to God the Father except through Christ Jesus. And you can, though God has so many promises over your life and over my life, and though God has a place that he has prepared for us, but if we do not follow Jesus, we do not obey his voice, then even though God has a place of promise for us, we will never enter into that place. Receiving Jesus, becoming born again, is not enough to have the manifestations of the promises of God in your life. Receiving Jesus in your life as your Lord and Savior is not enough to enter into that land that is flowing with milk and honey. You need to obey the voice of Jesus. You need to obey what he's commanding you to do. Jesus says, why do you call me Lord? If I'm truly your Lord, like you have said, why don't you do as I command you to do? The people of God in the wilderness, though they were all going to heaven, they received Jesus. Yet they did not obey the voice of the angel of the Lord or the voice of Jesus. And they wasted 40 years. If you ignore the word of God, Jesus and his word, they are one. In the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. In the book of Revelation, the Bible is saying to us that Jesus Christ is the word of God. So if you want to follow Jesus, it's simple. You need to follow what the word of God says about you, about your situation. In Hebrews chapter 4, Paul is telling us a sad thing, which is also a sad thing that is happening in the body of Christ. Hebrews chapter 4, Paul is telling us, there is a sad thing. Before even the foundation of the world, the Lamb, Christ Jesus, was already slain before the foundation of the world. And from the foundation of the world on the seventh day, God rested from all his works. So God has already finished everything that needs to be done in your life. And God will rest. And when Jesus hanged on that tree, he breathed his last breath and he said, "It is finished." There is nothing that Jesus can come and add to the work of the cross. That's why we have the Bible studies that they are called the perfect redemption plan. It is the perfect. There is nothing to add to it. To the sacrifice of Jesus at Calvary, there is nothing to be added to it. It is perfect. It is finished. It is a finished work. And even from the foundation of the world, God finished everything and then he rested. Everything that pertains to your life and to your godliness, God has already made a provision for it. The sad thing about many Christians, though they are no longer in the world, they've come into Christ Jesus, yet they are not obeying the voice of Jesus, who is the angel of the Lord, or the angel of the promise. God said to them in Exodus 23 that they need to beware not to disobey the voice of the angel of the Lord, not to go any other direction that the angel of the Lord is going, but to follow the angel. He's going before them, they need to follow the angel of the Lord. For you and I to enter into the manifestations of our promises, we need to follow Jesus. Jesus says, "My sheep," in John chapter 10, "My sheep, they hear my voice. And the voice of a stranger, they will not follow." For you and I to have the victory as Christians, we need to follow Jesus. And Paul in that Hebrews chapter 4, he says to us, "Though the works were finished even before the foundation of the world, the word that you are hearing today on this Sunday is the same word of God that they also heard in the wilderness, like I've read in Exodus chapter 23. But the Bible says, with many of them, God was not pleased." So, let us see the three categories of people that God was not pleased with. So, with many of them, God was not pleased. Three categories of people. Though they were delivered from Egypt, Egypt is the house of bondage. Crossing the Red Sea with the leadership of Moses is being born again for us. So, they were delivered from Egypt, the house of bondage, and they were translated into the kingdom of the Son of His love, like Paul explains to us in Colossians. Now, and they were circumcised, which is a symbol of God imputing His righteousness to us, and Christ Jesus has been made righteousness unto us. So, that is the equivalent of them being born again. But with some of them, God was not pleased. Those three categories. We will see that in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, from 1 to 4. These are the three categories. Though God delivered them from Egypt, yet they perish. Why? The first category are those who are idol worshippers. Moses went on the mountain to fast and pray for 40 days. At the feet of the mountain, they started to say, "We don't know what has happened to Moses. Maybe he's not going to come back. So Aaron, make us a god. Make us a god of gold that we would worship. God does not like worshipers. If you are worshipping an idol, you cannot be worshipping an idol, another god, and worshipping God at the same time." So when Moses came down from that mountain, 3,000 of those idol worshippers died. Though they were saved from Egypt, the same thing also Paul is telling us. If we are truly born again, we have been saved, and we continue in idol worship, then we are not. Numbers chapter 22, Numbers chapter 23, and Numbers chapter 26. Curse Israel. And he said in chapter 23, I cannot curse whom God has not cursed, and I cannot denounce whom God has not denounced. God has blessed them, and no one can change it. So when you are truly born again, you will be washed in the blood of the Lamb. In Exodus chapter 12, they sacrificed the Lamb. You've been washed in the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. You've been baptized through the baptism, not of the Red Sea, but the baptism of Christ Jesus for us. No devil on earth can curse you. No witch doctor can defeat you. No weapon that is fashioned or formed against you will be able to prosper. And this is from the mouth of the witch doctor. And he continues to say in verse 19 that God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should relent or change his word. He will not. God has blessed them, and nobody can change it. But Balaam said to Balak, this is the only way you can defeat them. If you entice them to do sexual immoralities. And we see how Balak sent women of Moab to go and commit sexual immoralities with the children of Israel. And then snakes entered into the camp and started to bite the children of God. They started to bite. 22,000 people died because of sexual immorality. So, sexual immoralities are the sins that are leading to them. Even if you are a Christian, if you are a Christian but you continue to live in sexual immorality, you will not go into heaven. That's why Paul says in that 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 to verse 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 to 11. He's talking to Christians. They were born again, but they were still carnal. Carnal means you are led by the flesh. You are not led by the word of God, but you are led by all your physical senses. You want to do what you want to do, what your flesh is dictating you, but you don't want to do what the voice of God or the word of God is telling you to do. So Paul says to them, do not be deceived. Many Christians are deceived. But Paul says, do not be deceived. Don't you know that the unrighteous, those that are practicing what is not right in the eyes of God, they will not enter heaven. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. He says, no fornicator, no adulterers, no homosexuals, these are the sexual immoralities, will enter the kingdom of God. No idolater, we've talked about idolatry, worshipping other gods, will enter into the kingdom. No thief, no murderer, and goes on with the list, shall inherit the kingdom of God. And some of us were like that. But now that we have received Christ Jesus, we decided to forsake all the other gods to serve only one God. We decided to stop living into sexual sin. No drunkard also will inherit the kingdom of God. We decided to stop drinking alcohol because we know that no drunkard shall inherit the kingdom of God. And we don't want to fall into that category of those 22,000 who died because of sexual immoralities, or of the free thousand that died because of idolatry when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments. And the third category is in Numbers chapter 16. Numbers chapter 16, rebellion against Christ and Jesus. We had Dathan, Korah, and Abiram. They rebelled against the leadership of Moses. Moses was a type of Christ, the one that we should all obey, according to Deuteronomy chapter 19, verse 15. Deuteronomy 19, verse 15 says that God would raise another prophet, just like Moses, and him everyone must believe in that prophet. So Moses was a type of Christ. So rebelling against Moses and his word was rebelling against Christ Jesus or the angel of the Lord. Like we read in chapter 23, you should not rebel against the angel of the Lord. Beware that you obey the angel of the Lord. So Dathan, Korah, and Abiram, they wanted to raise leaders for themselves and they rejected Jesus. And the Bible says, the earth split open and God sent them to hell. With all the possessions. So, for us, these are all the other spirits, Antichrist spirits, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, Islam, Christian Science, and all the other religions that have a false Christ in it. These are sin leading to death. These are rebellious religion that are rebelling against Christ Jesus. And if you are not into those categories, you are going to heaven. You are born again. But if you are born again and you are practicing, you are into those three categories, you are deceiving yourself. You are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Now, the sad thing that Paul is telling us in that Hebrews chapter 4, the word people, they were not into sexual immoralities. They were not into heresies or the rebellion of Dathan, Korah, and Abiram. And they were not into idolatry. Yet, and they were going to heaven. Yet, they did not enter into the promised land that is flowing with milk and honey. They did not have the manifestations of the promises that God spoke over their life. Why? Because the word Paul says in Hebrews chapter 4, the word that was spoken over their life, it did not profit them. They did not mix that word with the faith. They heard it, they said, "Ah, can God do this?" God said to them, "I've given you the land." They said, "No, there are challenges in the land. We cannot take the land." They were living right. They were not in sexual immoralities. They were not into heresies. And they were not into idolatry. Yet, they did not enter into the promised land flowing with milk and honey. One of the promises that we've read in Exodus chapter 23 from 20 to 28, he says that none in our midst will suffer miscarriage. And no one also in our midst will be barren. Now, God has given that promise. You are not into sexual immoralities. You are not into heresies. You are not into idolatry. You are serving the Lord in spirit and in truth. And God is saying to you, I'm making a promise to you that you will never be barren. But you'll be fruitful and you will multiply. You will never suffer miscarriage. When you are pregnant, you bring that pregnancy to term. But in your heart, you don't believe what God is saying. If you don't believe the word of God, God cannot help you. Even Jesus himself, he was in the angel of the Lord, or the angel of the presence of the Lord, was in the midst. But he could not help them because they did not obey his voice. God said, "Then beware that you obey the voice of the angel of the Lord that goes before you." Jesus, when he came physically 2,000 years ago, in his own city, the The Bible says it could not do mighty miracles. Why? Because of the unbelief. They said, "This Jesus, we know him, he grew up among us. Where does he get that wisdom and those miracles? Where did he get that power?" And Jesus said that he could not do mighty miracles in the midst. But if everyone who came to Jesus, he prayed for them and they were healed. And then he left for another city. So, for you and I to enter into the promise of God, we need to believe what God said to us. Let us not fall into those three categories like Moses told us and like Paul told us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 1 to 4. The sexually immoral, the idolaters, and those that are rebelling against Jesus, the heretic. But let us believe the word of God. That what God has spoken of our life will be surely come to pass. Let us mix the word of God that we hear with faith in our heart. Let us believe it. God, what you said about me will surely come to pass. You are not the man that should lie to me. Neither are you son of man that should change your mind. God, you said to me, every place that the soles of my feet shall tread upon, you have given me that place to possess. And I believe your word, I will surely possess this land in the name of Jesus. The Bible says Christ Jesus was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we were healed. But how come some Christians who are not living into sexual immoralities, they are not idolaters, and they are not into heresies, how come they are not healed? When they asked that question to Jesus, he said, because of your unbelief. He said, why could we not cast out these demons? Jesus said, this is because of your unbelief. You don't believe it. You don't believe. The man of God himself does not believe. And the people also, they do not believe. Though they read it. The first key thing is to believe what God said to you. Once you are born again, you are no longer practicing sexual immoralities. You are no longer doing idolatry. And you are no longer into heresy, rebelling against Jesus. You need now to believe what God said about you. Even if the pastor doesn't believe it, you need to believe it. And I'm telling you, because sometimes the pastors, they do not have faith. But you, your faith is as equal to the faith of Jesus, because he has given you the measure of faith. And Elijah, James chapter 4, James chapter 5, verse 17, James chapter 5, verse 17, James tells us that Elijah that called down fire from heaven, James chapter 5, verse 17, Elijah, who called down fire from heaven, who shut the heaven for 3 years and 6 months. He was a man that had the same nature like you. He was not a superman, he was a man like you, a man who was practicing righteousness. And the fervent prayer of the righteous man or of a righteous woman avails much. So your prayer has a power. If you are practicing the righteousness, you need to believe it, that your prayer is as good as the prayer of Jesus. And whatever Jesus said, you ask the Father in my name, the Father will do it for you. And sometimes when we read John chapter 14, John chapter 16, Jesus says to us, whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, he will do that for you. Whatsoever, it does not matter what you ask God for, he will do it for you. And do we believe it? Do we believe it? So, and Christians also, they are easily discouraged. They see oppositions And they think maybe it is not the will of God. It is always the will of God. God does not change his mind. As we saw last Sunday, he says, I am the Lord and I do not change. Heaven and earth may pass away, but my word will by no means pass away. You need to believe it. Because when challenges will come in life, then people will be saying, maybe it is not the will of God. So the word that they heard did not profit them because it did not enter the heart with faith. They did not mix it with faith. So that's why we are not having the results that God wants us to have. You are sick. They prayed for you once, and you did not see the immediate manifestation of your healing. And then you feel, oh, maybe it is not the will of God to heal you. It is always the will of God to heal you. He was wounded for your transgressions. He was bruised for your iniquities. The chastisement of your peace was upon him. And by his stripes, you were healed. God has not changed his mind. Heaven and earth will pass away, but that word that he accomplished 2,000 years ago at Calvary was by no means pass away. They nailed the feet of Jesus. Why did they nail the feet of Jesus? So that wherever the soles of your feet now will tread upon, God gives you possession of that land. You need to believe it and you need to receive it. Even when you have the positions before you. And God says to you and to me, that Exodus chapter 23 from verse 28, that if you obey the voice of the angel of the Lord or of Jesus, your enemies will become God's enemies. Your adversaries will become God's adversaries. Yours are the part that will become God's. God will be the one fighting them. That's why it is crucial to obey the voice of God, to obey the word of God. When I wake up in the morning, when I receive a mail from the council that they have a bill to pay, I take that bill and I raise it in heaven, that envelope. I say, God, you have mail. I don't have mail. You sent me to preach the gospel. I obeyed the word of God. You said, I will build my church. You did not say that Jerry will build your church. You said, I will build my church. And to build your church, it costs money. So you have a mayor. So you need to pay for the venue of the healing crusades, and you need to pay for the venue of the church meeting. And that's it. And I go. That's not my business. I believe he sent me. I believe I heard his voice. It is his responsibility to foot the bill. And God never failed me to foot the bill in the name of Jesus. You need to believe it. That he will take charge of his own work. That he will take charge of your life. We saw also last Sunday in Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 12. God said to Jeremiah, you have seen well. Why? Because I will watch over my word to perform it. God will watch over his word that he spoke to you. And he will accomplish it in your life. He will perform it in your life in the name of Jesus. But you need to believe. And you should not give up. In that Luke chapter 18, from 1 to 8, Jesus tells us in Luke chapter 18, from 1 to 8, man or woman, always go to pray and not be discouraged, not give up. You should never give up. You should never be discouraged in the name of Jesus. And he explains to us that woman, she came to the judge that did not fear God and did not regard the person of man. He was a wicked judge. But she kept on coming. Again, she was persistent. So be persistent in your prayer. There are some things in life you will ask, and it will be given unto you easily. Matthew chapter 7, from 7 to 12. Other things in life that you will need to search for them, to seek them with all your heart, and then you will find them. Just asking will not be enough. You need to look for them diligently with all your heart. Search for those things. There are other things that you need to knock for them, because there is a door that is preventing you to enter into that promised land. So you need to knock until that door is opened for you to enter. And sometimes it will not be opened gently. Isaiah 45 says from verse 1 that this is the word of God to Cyrus, is anointed. Cyrus is dead, but you are alive today. So put your name. This is the word of the Lord, Isaiah 45 from verse 1 to the end. It's the word of God to you. Isaiah counsel. That I go before you to make all the crooked ways straight, all the rough ways smooth, to break into pieces the gates of bronze, to cut into the bars of iron, and to open the double door before you. There are some doors that knocking gently will not be enough. You will need to wage warfare to take the sword of the Spirit. Jeremiah said, is not my word like a hammer, says the Lord. Is not my word like a fire, says the Lord. You need to use the hammer of the word of God to break those gates into pieces, to cut those bars of iron into two, so that those doors will be opened before you. So you should always pray. I should always pray, and I should never be discouraged, and I should never give up. And we saw in that Luke chapter 18 how that wicked judge that did not fear God nor regard the person of man, how he avenged that woman that came continuously. She was persistent in her demand. Christian, today they will pray once and then they will forget about it. You should pray through. You should pray until you see the manifestation of the promise of God in your life. Because God did not lie. We are the one who so easily give up. And in verse 7 and verse 8, now Jesus says to us, now you are a child of God. And you are not asking to a judge that is a wicked judge. You are asking to the judge of the universe that is a just judge. Isaiah says that God is the judge. God is the lawgiver. He is our redeemer, and he will save us. And you are coming to the judge of the universe, who is also your Father. Our Father who art in heaven is your Father. Jesus says, I go to my Father, and he's also your Father. I go to my God, and he's also your God. You are coming to your Father, who is the judge of the universe. So ought not, should not, God your Father avenge on the elect you. You are the elect of the Lord. And you are crying to God concerning your problem day and night. Jesus says to us, I'm telling you the truth. Not just your Father in heaven would avenge you, but he would avenge you speedily. And verse 8, this is now the consternation of Jesus. He's telling us, when the Son of God comes, will he still find faith on earth? Or will we just pray once and then give up? Or will we be persistent to pray until we see the manifestation of the promise of God in our life? Elijah, that we've seen in that James chapter 5, verse 17, that was a man that had the same nature like you. He shut the heaven for 3.5 years. But God spoke to him. Now there's the sound of abundance. And he went and prophesied to the king, thus says the Lord, God is going to send the rain today. So many of us would assume that because God prophesied something of our life, that it would just happen like that. No, you need to pray until you see the manifestation of it. And not give up. Elijah, after he had prophesied, did not go and eat. The king went to eat in the palace, and Elijah went on the mountain to do what? To pray. That's what we call to pray food. That basically you have to pray. He prayed food until he saw the rain pouring down. He did not go to rest. The fact that God has prophesied something does not mean that it will come to pass automatically. You and I need to take our responsibility. The problem in church, the reason why we are not seeing signs and wonders, because God will give us a prophecy, we will be so happy. Amen! We think it is over. No! You need now to pray until you see it on earth as it is in heaven. And Elijah prayed once. He said to his servant, go see. The servant went and looked. There was nothing. He came back. There was nothing. He prayed again. He said, go see. He went and looked outside. There was nothing. He said, he prayed again. The Bible there said that Elijah prayed 7 times. And 6 times there was nothing. But he did not give up. He knew God spoke. God is not a man who should lie to me, nor is he a son of man who should change his mind. If God says something, it is the truth. Let God be true and every man lie. God is not a man who should lie to me. So he said to me that there is a sign of abundance, the showers will be pouring down, so I believe. And then I need to do my part. My part is to pray and not give up. And the 7th time, the servant went down and saw, and there was a cloud, the signs of a man's hand. And then everything became black in the sky, and there was an abundance of rain. It is a sad thing when Paul is writing in Hebrews chapter 4, that the word that they heard did not profit them. They were so easily discouraged by the size of the giants. Many of us, we see immigration, and then we go get married to have papers. Because we see that, we think that that giant of immigration, we cannot defeat it otherwise unless we compromise. But if we pray, God will deliver us from immigration with our integrity, and our honor, we will not defile his temple that is our body. God will give us an answer that will lift our head on high, that will dignify us and will continue to honor him. With sickness and disease, the same thing. And so many have been healed of sicknesses and diseases. Jesus Christ was saying, yesterday, today and forever. My prayer for you and I in the house of prayer for all nations is that not just we are all born again, that you must be born again, according to John chapter 3, verse 7 and 8. There is no other way out. You must be born again. I must be born again. Repentance to God and faith in the blood of Jesus that was shed at Calvary for the remission of our sins, that's how we are born again. We turn our back from our old life, we stop sinning, and we follow Jesus. That's how we are born again. That none of us will be found into sexual immoralities, will be found into idolatry and witchcraft and all the other things. None of us also will be found into heresies or rebelling against Christ Jesus. And now, the next part of my prayer for you and I is that the word of God that we have heard, the special place that God is taking us, that is flowing with milk and honey, where we have houses filled with good things that we did not build, vineyards that we did not plant, according to Deuteronomy chapter 6, 9 to 11. Where he has promised that our vats will be overflowing with wine and with oil, our barns will be filled with grains, that when we would hear that word, would believe it. We will not doubt it, but we will believe it. Because that word did not profit them, because they did not mix it with the faith. And it is the same word that we are receiving today. If we hear the voice of his mouth, and we do not harden our heart, that there is the remains of promise for the children of God. So we will pray that you and I, we will enter into the promise of God.